Okay, so this is Mr. Dan Jenkins of Nimble Ape. Dan is going to talk about using Simwood webhooks for thermonuclear war, which wasn't the use case we originally envisaged, but I'm sure it'll be entertaining. Take it away, Dan.
Hello, can everyone hear me? I got many, many, many parts to my presentation, which means many, many ways for it to all go terribly, terribly wrong. So bear with me. But we have 45 minutes to, I think we've got 45 minutes for this talk, yeah, to kind of scramble our way through. And hopefully the other end will come out more knowledgeable about webhooks and APIs, and maybe a little bit more about thermonuclear war. So I'm just going to move this. Not in front of the slides. Ah, and you're all going, ah, oh, why has he got a Hue light bulb? You'll find out. Okay. Ready? That's going to get in the way. Okay. Shall we play a game? How about global thermonuclear war? So I'm Dan Jenkins. A little bit about me before you spend 40 minutes kind of going, what the hell is he talking about? I founded a company called Nimble Ape Limited 6 years ago. I love open source software. I'm a Google developer expert in web technologies. I'm not employed by Google. I do not get paid by Google. It's just a rubber stamp of approval. Dan knows his stuff when it comes to web tech, especially WebRTC. I love building Lego, fun fact. And I organized a conference called SimCon in the UK for the past 2 years. I'm also Dan_Jenkins on Twitter. Little bit about Nimble Ape. We're an RTC consultancy. We do an awful lot of WebRTC work. Asterisk, free switch, Camelio, OpenSIPS, and especially something called Dractio, which Simwood uses. And you'll be hearing more about that from Dave tomorrow, I think. Yep. We do a lot of native softphone app development with WebRTC and many, many, many other software development things. We're based in the UK, and that's our email address. So, shall we play a game? How about the global thermonuclear war? Who's seen War Games? Okay, better question. Who hasn't seen War Games? And you have to participate in this. Okay. Well, so this might not make any sense to you. We'll see. So War Games was a 1980s film, I think, where some guy, a kid, I can't remember his name, he uses his computer and his telephone line, and he tries to like scam games out of games companies so that he can access and play games sooner. So he calls in to loads of numbers in San Francisco area, I think, and then tries to communicate with them because it played back a tone at a certain point. And so he goes through these computers and connects to them. So the first one is a bank, and he goes, oh, that's not very interesting, but it might be useful later. And then the second one is a games computer. So he ends up, oh no, so he tries to log in and it says denied. And then he goes, oh, but there's always like back doors. So he tries list games, and it lists some games. So it lists chess, and it lists tic-tac-toe, that's later on. It lists a couple of games, and then it offers thermonuclear war. So he starts playing it because, you know, why wouldn't you play a game of thermonuclear war on a computer? Well, as it turns out, he did actually end up playing thermonuclear war with the US government and made the US government think that that they were under attack because there's a big computer in charge of everything. That's the long and short of it. It's a really good film. Go watch it if you haven't seen it. So shall we play a game of thermonuclear war? Simwood webhooks and API. Who's used Simwood's API? Ah, okay. Good, good. Who's used Simwood's webhook service? Oh, okay. this might be an interesting talk to 99% of people here. That's great. So APIs, you do a request and you get a response. That's just how APIs work, right? You do an HTTP request in this case, and you might say, oh, what's my credit? Tell me what my credit is, Simwood. And then they reply and say, oh, you've got 25p in your balance. Webhooks are completely the opposite. You run an HTTP service yourself, and then Simwood call that when something happens. So when you get an inbound phone call, for example, Simwood can do an HTTP request to you and say, ah, you want to know about inbound phone calls. So we're going to tell you about it. And they have many, many, many webhooks for different kinds of things. So that's a webhook. Talking about APIs is pretty boring. Like, you do a request and you get a response. And if you mash enough of them together, then you might actually be able to make something cool. I think the Simwood portal is built on top of all of these APIs. I can't actually see Simon because of these lights. Yes, thank you, Simon. So the Simwood portal that you all use uses all of these APIs. And so if you wanted to go and create your own dashboard or anything, then you could use exactly the same APIs that Simwood use. And that's a term called dogfooding, where you use your own stuff to enable your customers. So, I mean, I was talking to Simon about it. I was like, what kind of stuff do you want me to talk about? Like, what would you like me to submit as a talk? Like, last year I talked about web APIs, and I think the year before that I talked about WebRTC. I mean, I could talk about WebRTC again, but that's a bit boring. And he went, oh, well, the APIs and the webhooks are really interesting, and not many people know about them and what capabilities there are. So can you do something along those lines? I was like, okay, but how do I make APIs and webhooks interesting? It's from the film. So I thought, shall we play a game of thermonuclear war? Not like that. That ends badly. Maybe we might be hit. We might be going that way anyway with Corona, right? But maybe that's the only way to get rid of it. I don't believe that at all. It's complete and utter rubbish, but we'll carry on. So first off, let's take a look at the Simwood APIs. I'm going to go and paste. Don't look at that screen. So these are Simwood's API documentations. And would you like to know? They are 75 pages long. Did I write 77 in the slide? Anyway, I can't count. 75 pages long of documentation. I mean, it's very well documented. I will give Simwood that. But it's really difficult to like read all of this in and understand what is actually possible. Like, they tell you, like, you can go and do these requests, and this is how you format them. But I mean, that's a bit boring. So let's take a quick look at what's involved. So their API is HTTPS only. Every single good API nowadays should be HTTPS only, because why on earth would you send your customers' data / your data unencrypted? Side note, everything on the web should be encrypted, not just APIs. So even if you're running your own personal blog and that's on HTTP, go fix it. Like, you can get TLS certificates for free from a company called Let's Encrypt, an organization called Let's Encrypt, and they're pretty easy to use now. If you're using a blog or whatever through another provider, they should pretty much be offering you something now anyway. So everything on the web should be HTTPS, ran over. So their API is REST-based. Their V1 was SOAP-based. I'm not sure what their V2 was, but their V3 that we're now on is completely REST. And that means that it follows the mechanism of you get some data and you delete some data and you change some data. For some reason, my head has gone blank on what REST actually stands for. Anyone in the room? Jared.
Representative state transfer.
Representative state transfer. I would never have got that. And it's JSON-based. So JSON is just a way of us transferring data in a structured way. SOAP uses XML. Lots of REST APIs still use XML, but we all know that JSON is the best for data transfer, not for configuration files. Don't ever write a configuration file in JSON. I will hunt you down and do bad things to your JSON. But like I said, you can control pretty much everything that you can do in the portal. You can do it using the API, and probably even more. I must admit, I'm not really a Simwood customer. I have an account for some phone numbers and stuff, for testing stuff and looking at APIs and things. But I'm not a company that uses Simwood with thousands and thousands of minutes. I'm more of the tens of minutes customer. I am Simon's worst nightmare. But what can you do? I mean, take a look at this list. This is the list that I drew from that PDF, that really, really long PDF. But you can pretty much do anything that you want. So you can get real-time calls in progress. You can go off to their API and say, give me every single call that's in progress right now. You can get trunk balances. You can add rules to trunks. You can do number lookups. You can initiate porting using the API. You can send fax. Does anyone actually still send fax?
As a business, we do, yeah.
Oh. Not many. Oh. I feel bad for you. Yeah. So you can send fax, and you can send SMS. You can do loads of stuff using the API. And the API, even though the PDF isn't what I would prefer to consume all of that information in, when I'm trying to write a demo that is gonna be given to everyone in 3 days' time, but if you actually read that document and worked your way through it and figured out what was useful to you, then you could absolutely 100% go and build something with the API in the space of an hour in 30 minutes' time. It's pretty damn easy. Simwood's webhooks. So there's another document here. So the webhook documentation is actually at the end of this document as well, right at the very end somewhere. Received fax, is that a... Anyway, it's definitely at the end of the general API documentation, but in this case, I wanted to just show you the webhooks completely separately because it's easier to understand. And so this document... Ooh, this document is only 18 pages long in comparison, which is much more usable. So you can go into the portal and you can set up your webhooks. I think you can also do it via the API. I haven't tried. So you can configure your webhooks, and it will give you a load of JSON, something like this. So let's go back to my presentation. Webhooks. Where was I? Yes. So webhooks. Again, they are HTTPS only as well. But in this case, you have to be running an HTTPS server, and Simwood will not connect to an HTTP URI. And that's fantastic from Simwood perspective. As a customer of Simwood, I do not want Simwood to to, like, if someone made a mistake and just put HTTP into that URI that we've given to them, then Simwood could be sending me data that isn't encrypted, and that's bad. So they enforce only HTTPS URLs, and that's great. So you set a URL per webhook type, and I'll show you those types in a minute. And all of the webhooks are what we call an HTTP post request. So each request has a body of data, and that body is in JSON. And then Simwood expects us to reply with a 200, a 201, or a 202. 200 is okay with some data. 201 is created, i.e. there is no data, but we're kind of saying, okay, we've taken that data and we've created something with it. And then I think 202 is accepted. I might be wrong, but I think 202 is accepted without a reply body as well. So if you're really lazy, you can just send back a 200, but let's do HTTP properly. So in my code, I'm sending back a zero body with a 200. but I didn't have to tell you that because, you know, I'm not going to show you the. I might actually open source the demo. I will open source the demo. But yeah, what can you get from the webhook API? So you can get block calls. You can get calls in progress. Calls in progress is a little bit of an odd webhook in my opinion. So calls in progress doesn't get called every single time that there's a new call. Calls in progress just kind of, it happens on a timer, essentially. And so every 5 seconds or something, I don't know what the actual time is, but every X number of seconds, you get an HTTP request telling you what your calls in progress are. Personally, I'd just want that webhook to happen when there's a change of state, but that's how it currently is. But webhooks are in beta, so Simwood are open to changes. That's what their documentation tells me. So I'll be sending a support ticket after this talk, as should all of you for all of your Simwood needs. Call summary. And the two that I care most about for this demo, inbound call events and outbound call events. But what I thought was really cool was the number porting event. So what if you submit a porting request, and, you know, porting takes a long time, doesn't it? And you don't want to wait for an email reply or something to tell you that, oh yeah, that was successful. You can listen in on a webhook event to say, oh yeah, that number ported successfully, or that number ported unsuccessfully. And so you can programmatically deal with that scenario rather than having humans involved in the loop. So I thought that was pretty cool. But the two that I most care about today are inbound call events and outbound call events. Enough. Like, you promised us something cool, and APIs are really, really boring, and I can see people in the audience like yawning. I know. So give me the thermonuclear war. Absolutely. Okay. Let's exit that. Let's go over here. Let's close that screen and let's refresh. This makes no sense to anyone that hasn't seen the film. The guy that made the program is called Professor Falcon. And the computer talks to Professor Falcon. I thought that was pretty cool. I'm going to do that again. Like, this is all web driven. This is all web driven with web animations. It's a React app, and so I didn't have to really write any of this code at all. I just brought in code that other people had written and open source. Open source software is effing fantastic. Simwood's built on open source software. My whole business is built on open source software. And it's truly a brilliant thing. So this is a map of the world. And each of these red dots denotes a Simwood number that I have in my account. Thank you very much, Simwood, for providing me with very obscure numbers. So we've got a number in San Francisco. We've got a number in Manhattan. We've got a number in London. We've got another number in Warsaw, Poland, and Bratislava in Slovakia, and somewhere in Argentina, Buenos Aires, and Santiago in Chile. I really feel like we needed a pin over in Japan, but unfortunately, due to regulatory stuff, we couldn't get one, which is a shame. But never mind. So what we're going to do here is we're going to play a game of thermonuclear war. So let's take Bratislava, and we're going to call Bratislava. And hopefully I'm going to get audio. Yes. Did you hear those pings? I'll explain those in a minute. So this is some this is Slovakian folk music. And I've just muted that. This is a WebRTC call, by the way. And I can go over to New York, and I can call New York. That call to Slovakia is still happening. So this is New York, New York. I'm going to mute that really quickly, because if we put this onto YouTube, I don't want them to complain. San Francisco. Come on. Ah, there you go. It's a band from San Francisco talking about San Francisco. So I've got what, three calls open already? I need to go mute that. Let's go to Chile. And yep, great. That's also some Chilean folk music. And let's go to Argentina. And that's Madonna singing. But again, I'm going to mute it really quickly, because I don't want takedown notices on Simwood's account if they choose to put it anywhere. Oh yeah, I forgot London. Let's go listen to London.
Pope Benedict. Incidentally, he's called Pope Benedict.
So that's Jimmy Carr telling some really, really bad jokes.
Hang on, that's not a holiday source.
That's Jimmy Carr with some really, really bad jokes. So let's take a minute here. And I mean, I think I've got 45 quid's worth of credit. Let's see how much of a dent we can make in on-net calls. Simwood making money out of me. How do I get out of this view? Minimize. Okay. We've got a load of calls ongoing, and they should all last fine for 10 minutes. So let's go over to Postman. Does anyone know what Postman is? Okay, so Postman is a brilliant tool for interacting with APIs. So you can see here, I've got three tabs here. Not that you can really see them too much. Let's see whether or not I can make that a tad bigger. And you can see here, I've set some environment variables, so you can't see my password and my username. I will ask Simwood to reset my credentials after this. So this API call that you can see up here goes to api.simwood.com/v3/voice with the account ID and then in progress/current. So if I do this request, so it's a GET request, and you can see here all of my current calls. So this is pretty cool. You can, let's go back up to the top, answered count. So I currently have 12 calls, and that doesn't make sense, does it? It does make sense because I'm calling out, and then I'm receiving a call back in. And my current balance is £44.92. So we haven't made too much of a dent so far. Let's press send again. Oh, we're still at that. Okay. So, and it tells you approximately how many seconds I've got remaining before I hit zero. So that's good as well. So that's 84,929 seconds. 84,929. Divide that by 60 seconds. Divide that by 60. So, okay, we could be on the phone for a day. Is that my maths workout? Okay. So we're not going to run out of credit anytime soon. So that's good. So we can go take a look at our calls, and you can see where they are and how many calls are in each each code. I don't know what codes are though. Each breakout. Okay, this means more to you than it does to me. But each breakout is subcategorized here. So that's quite cool. But for me, and then countries, tells you how many light in each country. But for me, this is the most important one right now. So it tells me about every single channel. And so there's two here for every single call. So North America did to VoIP. North America did to VoIP. So that's because we've got two to North America. And I don't really know what all of these mean. But you can see here's the call ID. And we're calling from a Dover number, because that's where I live and run my business from, to 54115984200. And apparently 54 prefix is Argentina. I learned quite a bit about international prefixes while writing this talk. And you can see which trunk it all came under and how long it's been going for. And it's the same with every single one. So that's in progress. And then I haven't actually used this one before. I just picked it out roughly. So this is getting CDRs. So for each one of these, so you can see here, there's only six because there are only actual six calls. And then you can see the cost associated with each one, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that's really cool as well. But I'm not using that one in my demo. I just wanted to show off a couple of the API calls. And then you can do a number lookup. I was talking to Ross about this just before this talk, because this makes no sense to me. So this is my mobile number. I'm fine with you all knowing this and it all going out in video somewhere, because it's very, very public. And it says it's Telefonica UK Limited, but I'm not with O2. And before I was with EE, I was actually with Three. And Ross tried to explain this to me and I went, yeah, I know what you're talking about, but I don't. So Simon, why is this the way that it is? So what's the reason for it being the way that it is?
Thanks guys. What that's showing is who the range holder of that number is. So the block in mobile, in the case of mobiles, a block of 100,000 numbers.
You're right.
So that whole block of 100,000 is assigned to Telefonica, where you've ported it after, or where it was ported.
And apparently that's a MBR or something. I don't know. Ross said something.
MBR?
Oh, hold on. Let me.
We could take it offline if you want to do
HLR lookup?
Yeah, that's not a HLR lookup.
Yeah,
that's
simply this is an RH lookup.
Yes.
I don't know what those mean.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that makes sense, right? But I'm a web developer.
Yeah.
So you can do a number lookup using the API. You can do a ton of other stuff that is completely and utterly unique to your business. And that's pretty cool. But you can also kill calls using the API. So I thought we'd take a look at that. But before we do, you heard all of those dings while I was making all those calls, right? And I said, I'll tell you about that. So this is a result of those webhook API calls. So the webhook API is going to nimbleape.ngrok.io. If you don't know what ngrok is, go and Google ngrok.io if you're a developer. It is the best tool for developing things like webhooks. It gives you an HTTPS URL, and it gets tunneled to your machine. So you can develop webhook code, not just webhook code, any web code, locally and run it locally from your machine. There we go. And that's ngrok there. And it's just it's a really nice tool to be able to get traffic into your machine. So the server that's actually handling webhooks is actually running on my machine right now. It's not up in the cloud at all. And then you can see here, I received a post with inbound calls. I received a post with outbound calls. So each one of those calls that I made from that web GUI was both an inbound and an outbound call. And so I just took that webhook and let me go back to Briot. I just took that and I sent it over to my my Matrix server and sent it a webhook into Matrix. And so I can see that I made an outbound call was made from Dover to 56, a prefix of 56, which is Chile, I think. From an IP, so that's the IP of my asterisk box, I think. And this was the resulting call ID. And then you can see that another asterisk server then received an inbound call, blah, 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 blah. So that's just an example of how you can utilize webhooks. So let's go back to the fun. So I've still got all of those calls going on. You can hear Jimmy Carr
probably later on tonight, maybe tomorrow, the next day. Someone's going to say,
"You don't want to listen to him too long." He's really funny in person, but like when you watch a clip on YouTube of 20 funny Jimmy Carr jokes, not so much. Personal opinion. So Jimmy Carr's still talking, and Frank Sinatra is still
singing
New York. New York. It's another tool that I really wanted to show you, which is listed on the Simwood wiki. I must not be logged into the right asterisk server there, because some other calls should have happened. Anyway, so this is a tool called SNGrep. Who has heard of SNGrep? Great. If you don't know what SNGrep is, it's a fantastic tool for debugging SIP and RTP. So this is my asterisk server and it's being hammered because it's, you know, out on the internet, and fail to ban probably isn't working the way that I want it to work, considering I've got, in the space of what we've been talking about, over 1,000 requests. That's great. Well done. But, you can see here. So these are all of my invites that my asterisk server is receiving. And you can see, I want to show you a good call. If I go out of that one, because that's obviously not working properly. I don't understand why. It's maybe because it's coming in under TLS. Maybe none of this is going to work because it's all TLS. So SNGrep is a fantastic tool. And so you can see here the source, the destination, and call state. And so all of these are in call setup because none of them got answered properly. I think this isn't going to work because I've been listening on the wrong port, because I get all of my traffic from Simwood on 5061. As you should all do, because Simwood give you encryption free of charge. You can get encrypted media and encrypted signaling free of charge. I think that's bloody fantastic. I know of many, many, many other providers that will charge you for that. Sure, you've got overheads in having to now deal with encrypted media and encrypted signaling, but is your security worth it? Yes. So this is SNGrep. You can go into each one of these, and if I'd done it properly, I've only got 12 minutes left. Let's try and do this properly. SNGrep, dash dash help, I can't remember. SNGrep. Oh, it just doesn't work because it's encrypted. It's encrypted to, I'm not gonna be able to do it. Anyway, so this is SNGrep. And you can go into each message. I'm now waiting for a message. You can go into each message and you can take a look at each leg within that call. And you can see exactly what happened. And when media starts flowing, it will tell you, oh, both ends negotiated G722 or whatever. And media is flowing. None of these are going to work because these are all bad. But you can see here. And then what's really cool, if you do, if you start SNGrep with the right SNGrep dash dash help, I want RTP. So you can do SNGrep dash C dash R, and that will, this won't work right now because it's not receiving any media, because I receive all of my calls over TLS. But you can go into here and you can select the call that you want, and then you can do F2, and then you can save it as a PCAP. And then you can say, because you did it with the R flag, you can say, I want a PCAP with RTP. And so you can save that PCAP, and then you can send it to Kathleen in a support ticket, and she will love you forever. So SNGrep is a fantastic tool. And Sim would talk about it on their wiki. So let's go back to the demo. So we've got active calls. And they're all over WebRTC. Let's do some nuclear bombs, right? So I ran out of time. I really wanted to, you know, like in the movies where it like sends a nuclear bomb. And like you get a nice little graphic. I wanted to do a polyline that was curved, but I ran out of time. So let's go back. Oh, we didn't call Poland, of all places. I might have just broken it. Dan, you did too much. I just killed it. Anyway. So we can go back to Slovakian music. Took me a long time to find that in the chat. But we can drop a bomb on Slovakia. So let's do that. And you can hit. So you heard the ping. That's Riot Matrix telling me that a call was completed. And on my Google map. So one Riot got my thing, but did you all see my light flashing there in a very explosion-y way? And then there should have been a boom, but I think my phone has gone into silent mode or something. There should have been a boom. So you can see here, I'm terminating the call and then using an API. So I'll show you that in just a second. This is working really, really well. Yesterday there was a bit of a, like there was a 6 second lag between saying, kill this call, and it actually doing it. That's pretty damn good. There we go. Let's make sure that we've killed, you know, all of our calls. No sound effect. I knew it was risky. I'll take you through how all of this worked in just a second. Let's just make sure we've killed all of our calls. Without the boom, this is less climactic. Is that the right word? You know what I mean. Just a flashing red light. Look at the red light. So who's left? Chile. Boom. Boom. No. Okay. Damn it. I knew something was going to break. Apparently, so I made these circles the right size for a 25 megaton nuclear bomb, which apparently is what the US has. I'm a little bit disappointed, to be perfectly honest. Like, you'd think that these would be, like much bigger, but you understand now why, say, Russia has however many nuclear bombs, because like if they want to destroy the US, they're going to need a lot of them, right? Anyway, fun fact. So let's, with my 7 minutes left, I thought that went really, really well. What you don't know, there's so many moving parts to this demo. So let's take a look at what was involved very, very quickly and see whether or not we can have 5 minutes for questions or whatever. So there's a WebRTC client in that page. It's a React app. And it's using probably 10 different libraries, one to have JSZIP in there, which is a WebRTC library, the map from Google. I really wrote very, very little code for all of that, but I'll open source it after this talk because, you know, it's completely useless, but someone might find it interesting. So that WebRTC client goes up to my asterisk box in the cloud. That asterisk box then calls Simwood, and then Simwood then call out to another asterisk box. I wanted to make that differentiation, make it easier to understand instead of having everything kind of loop back in. And then asterisk then plays a sound file. It actually plays the same sound file 5 times because my talk was about 30 minutes long for the demo bit. There's enough of a sound file in there that the call wasn't going to end. I then do an API call from the browser to gather all of my active calls. And then using the results from that, I can go, oh, I called Argentina, so the number that I called, let's go find the channel that's applicable to Argentina. And in this case, there's two, because there's an outbound call and there's an inbound call. So I just pick one that I feel like choosing, and I kill it. And you do that using a delete request to Simwood's API. Interestingly, you can't do a delete request from the browser because of something called cores, and the Simwood API won't let me. So it actually sends up to my webhook server and proxies the request. Then on every single event that happened throughout all of that, I got a webhook. So every single time there was an inbound call, every single time there was an outbound call, and any state change within any of those, I got an HTTP request. And so on every single one of those, I would send that request off to Matrix. If you don't know what Matrix is fantastic. It's a decentralized chat engine, essentially, but you can use it for an awful lot of things. If you want to know more about Matrix, come talk to me afterwards. That's not the point of this talk. And then I also, on an end event, I can't remember whether or not it was the inbound or the outbound that I killed. On an end event, on a particular inbound or outbound, I called if this then that. If this then that is just an API for us to be able to interact with things and cause multiple things to happen. So I called an if this then that webhook, and that action within if this then that said, go blink a hue light and send a notification to my phone, to any phone that has if this then that app installed. So throughout that whole demo, my phone has just been vibrating in my pocket. And I set the notification sound to the sound of a bomb. And that's pretty much what made up the whole demo. And you're all probably thinking, well, that was interesting, but how is this useful to me? So for me, the API is really, really powerful, but the webhooks are actually much more powerful in terms of immediate gain. You can build all of your CDRs programmatically from Simwood. And to me, that's really powerful because that means that I can bill my customers if I had any. I could bill my customers using the data that Simwood are using to charge me. That's right, isn't it? Yeah. I just kind of assume that. Like,
some people do.
Oh, good. So that's a real good use for webhooks. There is no point trying to figure out when a call terminated to the customer. I just let Simwood tell you and send you a webhook every single time it happens so that you can then record it in your database with a timestamp. That's great. The API is brilliant because humans make mistakes. So configuring webhooks with an HTTP URL, well, that's not going to happen if you're using the API to do it and you've got code written to do it. So I don't know, porting seems like it's a complex thing. I don't know. I've never done it. Can you mute my HDMI, please? I've lost my train of thought. Humans make mistakes. So writing code that does the same thing over and over and over again, especially with something as complex as porting a number or whatever it is, having an API that does that surely makes everything far, far simpler in the long term. Do you need help integrating into Simwood's APIs? I do actually know what I'm talking about. Do you need anything with RTC? Again, I kind of know what I'm talking about. We can help you. Thank you very much. And I have 1 minute for questions. Thank you very much. Oh, and I forgot to bring business cards. So if you want to talk to me, but not talk to me right now, because, you know, Corona, take a picture. Thank you.